embarrassing.
Has COVID, so we're going to pray for Ken today. He came down diagnosed with that yesterday. He was able to play for the morning funeral, but that's the bad news. The good news is God has greatly blessed us with a lot of musical talent, and Margot is subbing in today, so let's thank her for pinch hitting at a moment's notice, and then late service Scott Eisenhower is going to play too, so we are really blessed. I've got a couple of announcements today. You see the three wise men there on the bulletin cover. We're still in the season of Epiphany, which means a revealing. And we've been started last week a series on how do we serve the Lord with the senses He's blessed us with. And we talked about hearing last week, how we need to be listening to God first, but also listening to others. That's a great way the Spirit helps us to connect them to Christ is by listening to them. So we want to have good listening ears. Today it's all about these here. You got to have soul. No, sorry. It's about feet. Do we have feet that follow? So last week we looked at the Old Testament reading Samuel, who says, "Speak, Lord, your servant hears." Today we're actually going to learn from a negative example, the story of Jonah. And his feet went in the opposite direction that God wanted him to go. And sometimes we find ourselves doing the same thing, not necessarily following, but in the gospel reading today, Jesus calls the disciples and it says immediately they left everything and followed him. So we want to follow the Lord with our feet and go where he sends us. On Wednesday, we have started at Wednesday night at 7 o'clock for the Connection Service, a series on living a life full of love. And this Wednesday actually ties really nicely with the message today, loving difficult people. And I challenge people to think about different relationships in your life and where does the love of God need to flow in a greater way through you and through difficult people. And that's part of what Jonah's problem was. He would have said the Ninevites are difficult people. We don't like them. In fact, they're our enemy. I don't want to love them, and I don't want God to love them. So I really encourage you to come join us Wednesday if you know somebody who's really wrestling with living a life of love with someone in their life. Bring them along and come join us Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And then there's an insert in your bulletin about next Sunday. So today we're having communion at both services because next Sunday we're not going to have communion at late service like we normally would do. This is a little flyer about our open house. It's going to be celebrating Messiah Lutheran School Week this week. The kids have special things going on all week long. But next Sunday, you are invited to our open house after the late service. The teachers are going to provide a meal, and then you can also stop in their rooms and check them out. So if you know anybody that has kids, grandkids, you know, this could be co-workers or relatives or friends, invite them to come. And there are also some extra of these on the pew as you walk outside there that you can pick up if you want to hand these off to somebody, just to give them a reminder and invite as well. I encourage you to do that. And something we're going to do this year, it's been several years since we've done it, our elders are going to invite all of the members to a potluck. So each month, starting in February, the first Sunday of the month, February, March, and April, three elders in February are going to invite their families. So get the chance to meet your elder, share what's going on, share prayer requests if you have questions about our mission and ministry. So the first three elders, Scott Molsness, Scott Eisenhower, and Warren Kaufman, they're going to do the February 4th one. So if you're one of their, under their care, it's all by alphabet, you should get a postcard and an email as an invite. And we're going to provide the main dish and ask you to bring a side dish or dessert to share. So, but nice opportunity to have some fellowship and help them get to know you too and how they can be praying for you as well. So those will be happening over the next three first Sundays of the month. And then before Lent season begins, we're going to have a prayer vigil. We've done this a couple times, a 24-hour prayer vigil, and there's a sign up over here. There's a table kind of over by the prayer chapel and welcome center. To sign up for a half-hour slot to be praying for our mission and our ministry, to be praying for your walk of faith. During Lent, midweek services this year, we're going to look at the seven times Jesus spoke from the cross. And during the prayer vigil, you can come here in the sanctuary for your half hour if you like. We're going to have the seven words posted around the sanctuary, but you can also pray from home if you'd like. And we have like four slots for each of those half hours, but we hopefully would fill up every half hour in that first column to know for 24 hours our church is just going to be bathed in prayer. So if you want to pick your slot, stop by there and sign your name, and we'll get you more information on some prayer starters as well. And if you have prayer requests you'd like to share and have people be lifting up during that prayer vigil, so that will be February 10th, Saturday the 10th. We'll start at 8 o'clock and go until Sunday the 11th, which is Transfiguration Sunday, when we celebrate how Jesus really showed his identity. The Father said, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him." So with that, let's go ahead and share the peace of the Lord before our opening hymn this morning.
Hey, Steve.
904, Blessed Jesus at Your Word. Sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I invite you to be seated, or you can use the kneeler if you'd like to kneel for our time of confession. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand for the liturgy today. We're just going to speak it, except for the This Is the Feast. Margo's going to play that for us, but the rest of the liturgy and the communion liturgy will speak this morning. So we continue as we speak the Kyrie. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. And we join in singing, This Is the Feast.
Goes to Nineveh. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. And when God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our next reading is Psalm 62, My Soul Waits for God Alone. For God alone, my world waits, I silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be greatly shaken. How long will all of you attack a man to batter him like a leaning wall, a tottering fence? They only plan to thrust him down from his high position. They take pleasure in falsehood. They bless with their mouths, but inwardly they curse. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Those of low estate are but a breath of those of the a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances they go up, they are together lighter than a breath. Put no trust in extortion. Set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, set not your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice I have heard this. That power belongs to God, and that to you, O Lord, belongs steadfast love. For you will render to a man according to his work. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the epistle reading is in the New Testament, in 1 Corinthians, the unmarried and the widowed. This is what I mean, brothers. The appointed time has grown very short. From now on, let those who have wives live as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no goods, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. I want you to be free from anxieties. The unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to please the Lord. But the married man is anxious about worldly things, how to please his wife, and his interests are redivided. And the unmarried or betrothed woman is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to be holy in body and spirit. But the married woman is anxious about worldly things, how to please her husband. I say this for your own benefit, not to lay any restraint upon you, but to promote good order and to secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We stand and we speak the Alleluia in verse. Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And together we join our voices in confessing our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. I want to welcome the kids up front. Pastor Myron is going to share the children's message with us today. And if you haven't yet, go ahead and fill out your Connect cards and pass those down the row.
Good to see you guys today. Glad you're here. Did you hear the one reading we just used these words called follow me? You ever have people that you follow along? Or you ever play follow the leader, right? You do whatever they say or whatever they do, something like that. All of us follow people in life, but I want to show you some characters that you might be familiar with. You guys might know these too. And if you were to follow that person, where do you think they'd take you? And these are pretty simple characters, so you know who that is, right? Mickey Mouse, if we were to follow Mickey, where do you think he would take us? Any ideas? Hopefully. To Disneyland or Disney World. That would be a good place to go, right? If you had somebody like that to follow. And I don't know if this character is around anymore yet or not, but do you know who that guy is? No. He's Ronald McDonald. Yeah. For us older folks, we recognize that one a little bit more. I think they've gotten rid of clowns or something like that. But if you followed Ronald McDonald, you'd end up at McDonald's, which is a good place. You guys like McDonald's? Not bad, right? Pretty good. Hopefully this one you still recognize, right? Winnie the Pooh. And if we followed him into the 100-acre woods, he might lead us to a big pot of, here it is, of honey, right? You guys like honey? Yeah. So, okay, all right. How about this one? Now this one is a little funner one. You know this guy, right? Spider-Man. All right. So if you were to follow Spider-Man, any idea where you'd end up? Probably flying through the sky on some kind of crazy adventure with buildings exploding and everything else. I don't know if I'd want to go there. That might be a little crazier. So, but in our reading for today, we talked about somebody else who said, follow me. And you know who that guy is, right? That's Jesus. And that, he invites us too. He said, follow me. And he told that to his disciples. Here's a picture of that. He said, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men, which is kind of different. It's not like they were going to throw nets in the water and catch men, but they'll catch people to help follow Jesus more. Any idea how we follow Jesus? Any ideas how we do that? How do we go about doing that? I bet you one way would be doing this, reading his word, listening to what he tells us, and maybe doing what he says and, you know, living the life that he wants us to live. That's one of the ways we follow him. But the interesting thing is when we do follow Jesus, here are some of the results. He doesn't lead us to honey, but a life overflowing with all kinds of goodness. You know, that's what following Jesus does for us. Following Jesus doesn't get us to McDonald's, but Jesus feeds us. And we find out how much he loves us and cares for us and just fills our lives with all kinds of good things. And we might not have adventures like this, but I know following Jesus takes us on incredible adventures. And the neat thing is he's always with us no matter what, which is great. And now we might not end up at Disney World or Disneyland, but following Jesus will definitely get us to heaven, the greatest, better than the greatest place on earth, the greatest place we can imagine. And that's such a wonderful thing for us. And let's pray and just ask God to help us follow him in whatever we do. Let's pray together. Dear Jesus, help us to learn.
Help us to learn
how to follow you.
How to follow you
in all we say and do.
In all we say and do.
By reading your word.
By reading your word
and listening to your voice.
Listening to your voice.
Help us to show others.
Help us to show others
how they can follow you too.
How they can follow you too.
In your name we pray.
In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming up today, and take those as you go back to your seat.
Thank you, Pastor Myron. We're going to sing Take My Life and Let It Be, and talking about our feet. Verse 2 says, Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. 783. Since we were little kids, the story of Jonah and the big fish. But here's the interesting thing. While Jonah is fleeing from God and God's command, God is pursuing Jonah. And not just pursuing Jonah, he's pursuing the entire city of Nineveh, you know, over 100,000 people. And he's sending Jonah in hot pursuit to go and share with them a message of repentance, a message to turn to the Lord. And so as during this Epiphany season, we're asking the Spirit to show us, to reveal to us, because that's what the word Epiphany means, how can we really be better followers of God with all of our senses? So again, last week, hearing Him, listening to His Word, right, and listening to each other's, to those to whom He sends us. But today we're going to talk about literally our feet. Our feet. So I want you to read, I'm going to read verse 1 of chapter 1, and then you read verse 2 with me. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. Now, you can see on the screen here, too, or in the Bible there, in chapter 3, here again, you see the word of the Lord coming to Jonah a second time. So read chapter 3, verse 2 with me. "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you." Yeah, the word of the Lord, and that phrase, you know, again, there's only 48 verses, and there are several times in here where not just that specific phrase, the word of the Lord, but God said, or the Lord said. So this is pretty important to God. It takes up that theme of, here is my word to you, here is my calling to you, here is where I am sending you. And to tie this into the gospel reading today, just like Jesus said to those disciples, follow me, I'm going to be sending you. In fact, you know, that's what the word apostles means. It literally means the sent ones. So will we listen? What kind of feet are we going to have? Are we going to have feet that are following? Or are we going to have feet that are fleeing? I thought about making a giant sign of Nineveh this way, you know, 1,000 miles is where our many miles it was, and then to say, just flipping it over on its head and saying, that's what Jonah did. So if you look at chapter 1 there, what does Jonah do? It says, but Jonah, look at chapter 1, verse 3, but Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. So Nineveh would be in modern-day Iraq. In fact, Mosul is about where the Old Testament city of Nineveh was. So, you know, that, if you look at it on a map, say, okay, so let me do your directions here. So here's Israel. That would be up over here. And he gets on a boat to go, like, almost to Spain, basically, completely in the opposite direction. Can you relate? How often do we do that, too? You know, God says, I really want you to do this. I'm like, okay. And we have fleeing feet instead of following feet. So we're going to learn some lessons today from the man who ran. The man who ran in a very opposite direction. You know, and in some ways, Jonah's one of those unfinished stories in the Bible. We don't really know what happened to Jonah. Kind of leaves it hanging there, leaves us hanging in suspense. And in many ways, too, it's a sad story. Because we don't really see Jonah's heart being turned, repenting. Even though this great city repented and turned and returned to the Lord. So, word of the Lord came to Jonah, and he says, no, I, in fact, this is if you grab your bulletin there. These are the three descriptors of Jonah's feet. And again, when we're really honest with ourselves and with the Lord, we have to say, yeah, sometimes I have those feet too. And so they all start with R, right? Rebelling feet, resentful feet, but also rescue feet. So let's look at the first one here. Lessons from the man who ran away from the Lord's sending. Rebelling feet to go in the opposite direction. You know, and that's really the definition of sin is God says, do this, and we say, I don't want to do that. Or God says, don't do that, and we say, I want to do that. So whenever we're rebelling against God and His will and His ways for us, we have those rebelling feet. But, you know, maybe we don't always think about it that strongly when it comes to being sent by Him to carry a message. And that's what Jonah was, that's what his job was. And it was a tough message, a call to repentance. You know, sometimes we're like, well, you know, that's pastor's job to go tell other people about Jesus. That's not my job. Is that true? Yes, it is my job. But not just because I'm a pastor, it's my job because I'm a Christian. So it's your job as a Christian too. He is sending your feet. And guess what? Your feet are going to go places I'm not going to go. Think about all the places, the feet in this sanctuary right now, or for the folks watching online, where your feet are going to take you that I'm not going to be. My feet are not going to be there. So those are the people to whom He's sending you. And yes, we can confess, Lord, sometimes I have those rebellious feet. And part of His rebellion is because He also had resentful feet. And you go, what? Well, what did He resent? Why would anyone begrudge God showing mercy to someone? Well, again, you kind of have to understand a little bit about the history. So Nineveh actually was hundreds of miles away from where Jonah was. But his problem wasn't, I have to travel this great distance. That was not the problem. The problem was, he had a great hatred in his heart for the people of Nineveh, because Nineveh was the capital at the time of Assyria. And Assyria was like one of the first, one of the nations that came in and conquered Jerusalem. So, you know, they were the enemies of their country. And so God's basically saying, and imagine this. So, like I said, Nineveh is modern day Mosul, Iraq. Imagine you get home and there's a message for you from God. And he says, I want you to go to Iraq and tell them about Jesus. And you're like, I don't want to go there. That's a long way. I don't want to go there. That's a dangerous place. I don't want to go there. I don't like those people. They're our enemy. But does God have enemies? Does he hate any human being? Or does he love every human being? You know, I said Wednesday night in our connection service this week, you know, we're going to look at being used by God to love people that are difficult to love. And guess what? Sometimes that's me. And sometimes that's you. We're not always lovable. Sometimes it's hard for people to love us too. But God does love us. And God doesn't want us to resent his grace. So I want you to look at chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. So this is after, you know, God, he rebels, he gets on the boat, if you remember the story. I'll come back to that again about how God saves him with the great fish. But part of the resentment you see in chapter 4. So let's read chapter 4, verses 1 and 2 together. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. I mean, this is such a great story. So, you know, Jonah rebels, goes down to the sea, books passage on a ship going in the opposite direction. This great storm, you know, comes up, and the sailors are trying to save everybody, and then they cast lots, and it falls on Jonah, and Jonah says, yeah, it's me, I disobeyed the Lord. And they said, the only way you're going to be saved is if you throw me overboard. So they do that, and the sea goes calm. And here's Jonah, you know, in the midst of the Mediterranean Sea. He's going to drown. He's going to die. But the Lord rescues him. We'll come back to that here in a minute. Well, this idea, that's the third one here. He has rescued feet. But the whole reason Jonah was willing to go through that and flee is because he had this deep, deep resentment, even hatred for these people. And, you know, we can see that too in our own lives too. There's people that we find ourselves prejudging, right? That's where the word prejudice comes from. And it can be from all kinds of reasons. I have to admit, I had a little bit of joy that the Green Bay Packers lost last night as a Chicago Bear fan. But not that I'm resentful that our team stinks this year, you know. But see how, we laugh about that, you know, that's kind of a lighthearted thing, sports and all that. But how sad it is that we have all these walls of hostility that separate us from each other. Because this is something I truly, truly believe that Scripture teaches. There really is only one race, the human race. And we are all God's loved children. And he wants everyone, Scripture says, he wants everyone to know him. Now, so sometimes it can be the color of our skin, you know, that causes resentment. Sometimes it can be socioeconomic status. Sometimes it can be, you know, where we come from, whatever it is. So sometimes we have those rebellious, resentful feet too. We don't want people to be shown God's love and mercy. But here's, to me, if you don't take anything else away from the message today, and I want to encourage you, go back and read, you know, you can read the whole book of Jonah in about 5 minutes. Read it in your some quiet time this week, and pray about your feet. What kind of feet do you have? Do you find them rebelling and resentful? But we all definitely can say Jonah had rescued feet too, and it was a pretty unique rescue. And you and I have rescued feet too, because the Lord sent his son. You know, we just said that in the creed, who for us men and for our salvation, Jesus came down from heaven, was incarnate to rescue you and me. And not just our feet, not just our bodies, but our souls as well. So, I mean, he had rescued feet, but again, he was pretty begrudging. And in many ways, Jonah is a real life story of resentment, very much like the parable that Jesus tells of a resentful brother. We call it the prodigal son, right? But it's really about two lost sons. Because the young son ran away, you know, and blew all the inheritance. Yeah, he was pretty lost too. But the older brother, when the younger brother comes back, was he glad? Was he glad that the father loved him? Was he glad that the father had been waiting and longing for the lost son to return? No. And they're throwing a big party. He says, I'm not even going in there. And when you read the story of Jonah, you know, he goes and he preaches the message, and then he goes outside of town and he puts down his little lawn chair and he kicks back, and God sends this beautiful plant to grow up that gives him this nice shade. And he's sitting there and he's eating his popcorn. He's going, man, I can't wait to see the Lord pulverize this town. Let him have it, Lord. But that doesn't happen. Because guess what? The word of the Lord that came to Jonah that he preached, repent. Return to God. The whole city repented, including the king. And it says they put on the sackcloth and the ashes, and they said, no, we understand who the real, true God is. And they repented, and God spared them. And Jonah was mad. It was a pretty sad feat. And even though he was rescued, and that's chapter 2, this is a beautiful prayer, Jonah's prayer in chapter 2, because here the end of chapter 1, verse 17 says, and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. And by the way, some people say, well, that couldn't have happened, that never happened, that's just an allegory or whatever. Well, listen to these words of Jesus. He believed in the story of Jonah. In Matthew 12, verse 40, Jesus said, for just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. You know, and I would say this is amazing. You know, somebody would say, well, do you believe Jesus is God? He came to the earth. And you go, yeah. Do you believe he died and rose again? Yeah. Do you believe Jonah was swallowed and lived in a fish? No, that couldn't have happened. I'm like, well, wait a minute. Either God is God or he's not. And if he's God, he can do anything. And that word is, I like the translation here in the ESV. The Lord appointed a great fish. The Lord provided. And we don't really know what that was. You know, the kid's stories only says whale or whatever, but that's not really the word that's used in Hebrew. It just says a big fish, big enough to swallow Jonah. And he's in there 3 days and then spits him out on the dry land. But it rescued him. And you look at that, because here's what's happening to Jonah. And by the way, it's what happens to us too when we rebel and go the wrong direction. Jonah was on a downward trajectory. In fact, you can look at these verses here. I'm just going to read them kind of as we go along here. In chapter 1, verse 3, it says, and Jonah went down to Joppa. And it's kind of, he says it. And then he gets on the boat, and it says, and then he went down below the deck of the ship. And then in Jonah 1:5, it says he goes down in the depths of the sea, then when they throw him overboard, he's sinking down, and God provides the rescue. And that's true for all of us too. We are sinking and we are on a downward trajectory until the Lord rescues us. And thanks be to God, he did. So not only does Jonah have rescue feet, but we do too. And so let's look at a more positive side. And this is true. These two commands from Jesus, that we hear from God to Jonah, are the Lord's commands to us today. Arise and go. And pardon me for saying it this way, but arise. Now you don't literally have to do that right now. But in essence, what God is saying is get off your spiritual butt. And get going, because I got some work for you to do. And it's so easy for us as Christians to get complacent and go, well, I'm good. You know, I don't care so much about them that don't know Jesus. But they're dying without us. So, when you read arise, think about that and say, well, where do I need to kind of get up and get after it? And then go. Because God is a sending God. Those disciples, when Jesus said, follow me, then he sent them. They were the apostles, the first ones, and we're his apostles today. We're the sent ones. Go. We say in the creed, I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. You can say it this way. I believe in one holy Christian and sent church. We are the sent ones. And we can go because we have feet that, first of all, are following. And this is a great thing, you know, when you think about it. You know, when Jesus said to the disciples, follow me, that in the command to follow means he's there. You're following him. He is the lead. And this is something that I think sometimes maybe why we're reluctant and we don't follow is we think we're going all by ourselves. And we are not. In fact, we never, ever go in the name of the Lord by ourselves. We are following Jesus. He's promised to be with us. And also, the Holy Spirit is there. The Holy Spirit was there working in the hearts of those 122,000 or whatever the number was, Ninevites, to change their hearts, to turn to the Lord. That's actually what the word repent means, remember? It means to turn back to the Lord. So we can say we have following feet because we have forgiven feet. Our feet have been forgiven. And Jesus kind of showed that even in a pretty cool way. On Monday, Thursday, remember, they were ready to celebrate the Last Supper, the Passover, and it says Jesus gets up and takes off his outer garment and wraps the servant's towel around his waist, and what does he do? He washed the disciples' feet. He says, here, I've set you an example about love and service. But in many ways, it's a reminder, too, you know, and I wasn't just washing the dirt off their feet, it was reminding them that's the whole reason he was about to go to the cross, was so that they could be forgiven. So we have following feet because we have forgiven feet. But this is where Jonah, the story, as I said, is kind of sad. And even in his prayer, when you read it in chapter 2, there's two components that are missing. So this is there's some good lessons we can learn from Jonah, but there's more. There's more. And then when you read chapter 2 and you read the prayer, this is important to do when you're going the wrong direction. Number one, you got to realize you're going the wrong direction. All right? You got to realize I'm in danger. Okay, that's number one. Number two, in fact, you want to write this down on your sermon notes there. Realize you're in danger. Number two, remember that God is the deliverer and has delivered us. You know, and that's a prayer of thanksgiving. Jonah prays from the belly of the fish. Thank you for providing this great fish to save me from drowning. But what's missing in Jonah's prayer is we don't ever hear him repent to say, I am sorry, Lord, that I didn't go where you sent me. So that's a third R. So we got realize you're in danger, remember God's the deliverer, repent and turn back to God. And then this is the word in sign language for forgiveness. The fourth R, again, that's missing from Jonah's prayer is release. Because not only are we forgiven, we're called to be forgiving, to forgive others. And, you know, like I said, Wednesday when we talk about loving those that are difficult, because sometimes it's hard, they've hurt us, so it's hard to love them. They've wronged us, so we want to hold on. The devil wants us to hold on too. He doesn't want us to release. He doesn't want us to forgive. He wants us to hold that grudge. But we have forgiven and forgiving feet. So here's kind of the takeaway for me from Jonah. Jonah is the story of two X's. Experiencing God's mercy, that's the first X. You and I have experienced the mercy of God. But we're also supposed to extend, that's the second X. Extend the mercy of God. Following feet, forgiven feet, forgiving feet. So who is your Nineveh? Arise and go. Amen. And may that peace and that power to love and forgive that comes from Jesus Christ fill our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. And we worship the Lord now and give him thanks with our gifts and tithes and offerings. And Margo's going to play a little offering for us as we do that. Service here yesterday, and he always liked to put the baptismal banner out there to celebrate his life and faith and eternal life, and so we'll include his family in our prayers, and certainly for Ken, he's dealing with his COVID diagnosis, so we pray that that does not last long and want to lift him up. So we'll use that response that you see there, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as you called those first disciples, come follow me, and they obediently left their nets and followed you. But also Jonah, as he heard your call and your sending, he had fleeing feet. We recognize at times we do that too. We don't follow you always with our thoughts and words and literally with our actions and where our feet go. So we thank you for the gift of forgiveness that we have been forgiven freely, and we pray, Holy Spirit, you empower us to be forgiving freely. And as we ponder the story of Jonah, those to whom you're sending us, may we be a bold witness for you as we share the word of the Lord with them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be with the Ron Yoxheimer's family as they mourn his death, but also celebrate his homecoming, and we echo those prayers for others in our church family who are dealing with the death of a loved one or whose end of life on this earth is drawing to a close. Comfort them and use us as your comforters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for all of our mission and ministry opportunities, Holy Spirit, but this week we pause to give you thanks for the privilege we have through our early childhood center and our Christian day school to share the love, hope, and peace of Christ with these children and with their families. And as we have our open house and make some new connections to you, Lord, may your blessing be upon Sarah and Linda, our administrators. May it be upon all of our teachers and support staff, and bless them. Bless our children and their families, and we lift up the new families, Lord, and new connections, and as you send us out to make those connections, Lord, may we be instruments of your loving care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue our prayers for those in our church family battling cancer and dealing with illness and disease. We lift up Ken to you and pray that the medications he's receiving can help deal with the symptoms of COVID, and that he can return to his service at our school and helping lead the music and direct our choirs. And he has such a heart and passion for sharing his musical gifts and helping others to do that. Be with Robert Gray and Jamie Davis as they have surgeries this week. Guide the hands of those that will be caring for them. We lift up Rebecca Henson's cousin Courtney as she recovers from the removal of a brain tumor that she had on the 12th. And we also lift up former pastors, both of Margie Meyer and Jeannie Heitman, that your hand of healing and strength can be upon them with their health care issues. We rejoice in the gifts of medicines and the skills of doctors and nurses and therapists, all wonderful blessings of your loving care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now we prepare our hearts to come to the Lord's table, and we'll join in again speaking the communion liturgy, beginning on page 160 with the preface. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty God, Everlasting Father. For on this day our Lord Christ overcame sin and death and the devil, and opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on that night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. The same way, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. We speak together in August day. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Amen. And you may be seated. We do welcome you to the Lord's table, and we join in our first communion hymn, Thy Word. Thank you. welcome you to the Lord's Day. Continue as we join in, come follow me. Speak together the canticle. Thank the Lord and sing his praise. tell everyone what he has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises and leads his people forth in joy with shouts of thanksgiving. Alleluia, alleluia. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. And we do arise and we go forth in the name of the Lord and with his word, and we sing Onward Christian Soldiers, hymn 662. Thank you.
what to do.